Good morning. Our service this morning begins with the opening hymn, number 366 in the hymnal, if you are here physically, and in your leaflet, if you are joining us remotely. Holy God, we praise thy name. Led by the choir of the Cathedral Church of St. John the Divine. Alleluia, unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, alleluia. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Glory be to God on The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Set us free, O God, from the bondage of our sins, and give us, we beseech thee, the liberty of that abundant life which thou hast manifested to us in thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the reading of the first lesson, which, and all the lessons for that matter, which will be wonderfully, individually and collectively and remotely, read by the Silva family.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah, chapter six, beginning at the first verse. In those days, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Above him stood the seraphim. Each had six wings. With two he covered his face, and with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory, and the foundations of the thresholds shook at the voice of him who called, and the house was filled with smoke. And I said, woe is me, for I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Then flew one of the seraphim to me, having in his hands a burning coal, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. And he touched my mouth and said, behold, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away and your sin forgiven. And I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send and who will go for it? And I said, here am I, send me. The word of the Lord. The word of
thanks
the Lord.
Be to God.
I will read the psalm and we will read responsibly, dividing at the asterisk. I will give thanks to you, O Lord, with my whole heart.
Before the gods, I will sing your praise.
I will bow down toward your holy temple and praise your name.
Because of your love and faithfulness.
For you have glorified your name.
And your word above all things.
When I called, you answered me, and you increased my strength. When I called, you answered me.
You increased your strength within me.
All the kings of the earth will praise you, O Lord.
When they have heard the words of your mouth,
they will sing of the ways of the Lord.
That great is the glory of the Lord.
Though the Lord be high, he cares for the lowly.
He perceives the haughty from afar.
Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you keep me safe.
You stretch forth your hand against the fury of my enemies. Your right hand shall save me.
The Lord will make good his purpose for me.
O Lord, your love endures forever. Do not abandon the works of your hands.
Reading from St. Paul's first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 15, beginning at the first verse. Brethren, now I would remind you in what terms I preached to you the gospel, which you received, in which you stand, by which you are saved, if you hold it fast, unless you believed in accordance with the scriptures.
In vain.
For I delivered to you as the first importance, which what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12, then he appeared to more than 500 brethren at one time. Most of whom are still alive, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. For the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me was not in vain. And on the contrary, I worked harder than any of them. But the grace of God is which is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we preach, so you believe. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Our sequence hymn is number 126. We'll sing the first two verses before the gospel and the third and fourth verse after. Hymn 126, The People Who in Darkness Walked.
Thank you.
Please stand for the reading of the gospel. The Lord be with you. The continuation of the Holy Gospel according to Luke. At that time, while the people were pressed upon him to hear the word of God, Jesus was standing by the lake of Gennesaret, and he saw two boats by the lake, but the fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. Getting into one of the boats, which was Simon's, he asked him to put out a little bit from the land, and he sat down and taught the people from the boat. And when he had ceased speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch." And Simon answered, "Master, we toiled all night and took nothing, but at your word, I will let down the nets." And when they had done this, they enclosed a great shoal of fish. And as their nets were breaking, they beckoned to their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both the boats, so that they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord." For he was astonished, and all that were with him at the catch of fish which they had taken. And so also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. Henceforth you will be catching men." And when they had brought their boats to land, they left everything and followed him. The gospel of the Lord. Praise be to thee, O Christ. From today's reading from the prophet Isaiah, "Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?" Then I said, "Here am I, send me." In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Today's gospel, and perhaps the something teen weather out there that seems to permeate the walls of the church. Bruce, we'll have to put on the list insulation for this year. Puts me in the mind of summertime and fishing in the Mediterranean Sea, which was the very same climate of Lake Gennesaret where Jesus and his first four disciples, as described in Luke's gospel today, were. I'm fortunate twice over to be married to a Franco-Grec. My wife is French, and thus she cooks well, and she's Greek, and thus we vacation well in the home of her family. And each summer, we spend time where we disconnect from the world we know, from the Western world entirely. We worship in a Greek Orthodox church where it is all Greek to me. Fortunately, I studied a little of it, so I catch phrases, but I'm enveloped by the shape of the liturgy and the beauty of the liturgy without being distracted by what the priest is trying to say in his sermon. But what impresses me most is how similar the day-to-day life of the people working on the island are. When the gospel describes they had finished and they were mending their nets, every morning when we get up and we go down into the town of Nausa on the island of Paros, we see them. The nets are now made of synthetic fabric, but they need to be cleaned every day or they degrade just as cotton would have or linen would have. They need to mend them because a good net is only as good as it is free of holes. And so each day they're out there mending their nets, washing their nets at early morning time because they've been fishing all night long, just as these men were in today's gospel. And so I know the climate of today's gospel. These were tired, hardworking individuals who had just spent all night long. They had gone out at midnight. They'd returned at 5 a.m. and it was now 7 or 8 and they were exhausted. And after Jesus finished his sermon, he said to them, well, let's go back out to the deep waters. Take the nets you've just cleaned and mended. After your 8 hours on the water and your hour listening to me, let's go out to work again. And it shows the esteem in which this person in their midst was held, that they said yes at all. And so they went. And the catch that they brought was amazing. What was the miracle here? What was the real question? Was it where to fish? They'd fished there the night before. Was it when to fish? That's not so much a miracle. You look that up, you figure it out, it's trial and error. Or was the real lesson in today's gospel for what to fish? Today's gospel ends. As you follow me, you will no longer be fishing for fish, it is implied, but you will fish for men, you will fish for people. It sounds better, fishermen versus fish for men. He meant that purely inclusively. You'll be fishing for people. What did he mean there? I bring us back to that first lesson. And by the way, thank you, Silvas, for reading the lessons today so enthusiastically and wonderfully. And in today's offertory anthem, listen for your first lesson to be heard again. 'Twas in the year that King Uzziah died. A vision by Isaiah was espied. It's a Renaissance anthem on this lesson that you just read so wonderfully. And the image that Isaiah was talking about was of a cherubim and seraphim, two types of angels with different varieties of wings, taking a set of tongs, you know, that you might pick up something hot with from a barbecue, quite literally, and going up to the altar in the temple, and picking up a coal from a pot of incense, which didn't look unlike a Weber grill, and picking up a hot coal and pressing it to the lips of the subject of the vision. That's an image of a lesson that is read at ordinations to the priesthood, because this lesson is about calling. And it's always struck me as something that's going to hurt a lot. Pressing lips to hot coals out of an incense burner sounds painful to me. It's probably not meant to be about physical pain being advisable. What is it about? It's about the cleansing nature of fire. It's about, in our gospel reading, the cleansing nature of water. Fire can both destroy and cleanse. Water can both destroy, as we saw in our basements this summer twice here at the church, and it can cleanse, as we see so frequently now in our baptismal font. And what is the difference? The difference is the presence of God. The difference is, why are we doing something? not what are we doing. The difference isn't where are you fishing or when are you fishing, but for what are you fishing? In our own lives, and I'll speak for myself personally, I can get in a funk where I'm stuck, where something has just thrown me off and I can't seem to get out of it. In my life, it's a well-worn pattern, and I've come to know about it. And I know how to get out of it. I pray more, I exercise more, I eat less. It's simple stuff. It's hard to do, but I know how to do it. For younger people, as I sat with a 17-year-old this week, they're doing things for the first time and encountering frustrations for the first time. And they are not equipped for those things. And so, children, ask your parents, because you know what? They've done this stuff. And when times are tough, ask them. And parents, when times are tough, ask each other. And ask your parents if they're still around and you're blessed to have them. And ask your friends and ask people at church. We've all gone through what you're going through, and we've all felt the separation. We've all been in the funk, even if it isn't exactly what you're going through. And we can at the very least commiserate. We can suffer with you. Because that's part of what Christian fellowship is. It's having brothers and sisters in the faith to share the burden, that I can unload some of my burden to you just by talking about it. Whom shall I send, and who will go for us? Isaiah heard the voice of the Lord saying. And he said, here am I. Send me. In today's gospel, Peter and the unnamed brother Andrew, James and John were the ones called to leave their nets and follow Christ and no longer fish for fish, but rather fish for men in the name of Christ. May we so also, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. We continue with the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us, for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Beloved, greet one another in the name of the Lord. Good morning. It's wonderful to see those of you who are here in person and those who are here on Zoom. We look forward to connecting with all of you over some coffee immediately following, as has become our pattern. I wanted to share with you the sad news, which some have already been made aware of, that our sextons, Jorge and Elkin, who help us in so many ways, their mother, Abigail, died this past week. And I've spoken with Elkin, and he's very sad. They lost their father 4 years ago. She was 90 and led a full and happy and good life. And he feels great about her and their relationship, and it's a good time, he said, and yet it's also very sad. And so please keep Elkin and Jorge in your prayers as we remember Abigail Marin at the altar today. I was mindful during the epistle today when they talked about, and many of whom are still alive today, talking about 500, though some have fallen asleep. Yes. Indeed, her funeral, I think, was two Saturdays ago. And indeed, we remember Joan as well. And in the same vein, we think that phrase that often you go through cemeteries, and it was a Victorian phrase, where you see "Asleep in the Lord" written on tombstones. And I actually rather like that image, the image that eternal life for Christians begins now. And it may only be interrupted by death, at which point we cease to understand what temporality means and God's time takes over. But I like that phrase from our perspective. Asleep in the Lord. May we walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself an offering and sacrifice to God. And beware Silva House, here comes King Uzziah again.
Thank you.
This Holy Eucharist is offered to the glory and praise of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. For the special intentions which each of us brings to this altar this day in our hearts, and particularly for the repose of the souls of Abigail Marine and Joan Towles. Rest eternal grant unto them, O Lord, let light perpetual shine upon them. May they rest in peace. Amen. May the souls of the faithful through the mercy of God rest in peace. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks unto our Lord God. It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, almighty everlasting God, because in the mystery of the Word made flesh thou hast caused a new light to shine in our hearts, to give the knowledge of thy glory in the face of thy Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, All glory be to thee, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, for that thou of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there by his one oblation of himself once offered, a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute, and in his holy gospel command us to continue, a perpetual memory of that his precious death and sacrifice until his coming again. For in the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is given for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it in remembrance of me." Wherefore, O Lord and Heavenly Father, according to the institution of thy dearly beloved Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, we, thy humble servants, do celebrate and make here before thy divine majesty with these thy holy gifts, which we now offer unto thee, the memorial thy Son hath commanded us to make, having in remembrance his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, rendering unto thee most hearty thanks for the innumerable benefits procured unto us by the same. And we most humbly beseech thee, O merciful Father, to hear us, and of thy almighty goodness vouchsafe to bless and sanctify with thy word and Holy Spirit these thy gifts and creatures of bread and wine, But we, receiving them according to thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ's holy institution, may, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. And we earnestly desire thy fatherly goodness mercifully to accept this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant that by the merits and death of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee that we and all others who shall be partakers of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ, be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and made one body with him that he may dwell in us and we in him. And although we are unworthy through our manifold sins to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, by whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ hath taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him that taketh away the sins of the world. Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my soul shall be healed. Yeah. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Having presented our oblations unto thee, O Lord, in remembrance of the manifestation of thy newborn Son, and having beseeched thee that as he is the author of these gifts, so he may also mercifully receive the same, we beseech thee now to prevent us with thy heavenly light, that we may discern with a pure mind and receive with due devotion the mystery of which thou hast willed us to be partakers, through the same Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord, who with thee in the unity of the Holy Ghost liveth and reigneth God throughout all ages, world without end. Amen. Depart in peace to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 535. Ye servants of God, your master proclaim.